Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. I'm Amethyst Lunatari, and this is a Let's Play where at the end of the video you get to choose what option going forward we are to take into the next. And where were these skeletons? These funny skeletons. The Altar of Ilmon. The skeleton begins to ask you a question, but then staggers back as though struck. He falls to the ground, dead. You lean down to check where he has fallen. After a few seconds, another drop of water splashes against him, and he sits up with a howl. "Where am I?" he says. Once more, the skeleton waves his sword in front of the altar as though he does not remember you. Now, the majority vote for the last episode is to cast a spell, which I said would be the slowness spell. I don't remember what that is. Cause slowness, which is going to take away 1 point out of our 5 stamina pool right now. Consulting the constellations overhead, you bind the spell, and the skeleton's jerky movements slow significantly. It steps towards you, its foot seeming to hover in the air. You can easily dodge around it now. Slipping past the slow grasp of the skeleton, you walk up to the altar. Okay. I was hoping it would just keep the skeleton alive longer, so we can, you know, talk to it without it becoming inanimate again. But yeah, if we can approach the altar, that'd be a good thing, I guess. You stand before the altar. The altar is a simple stone block with a few simple carvings of waves and waving plants. Scratched into the stone is a simple glyph, 4 slash lines, like the Roman numeral. You know, I've seen the Roman numeral 4 with 4 lines before on a clock. I always found it funny it wasn't the IV, it's the 4 I's. You touch the glyph. It is crudely carved. A later addition, perhaps? Let's collect some dripping water. You unstop one of your empty vials and hold it out, filling it from the water dripping from the whale's mouth. Holy water. Oh. So that's what's happening. They're being resurrected for a certain amount of time. Drink? Go up to 7. Although the idea is revolting, you raise the vial to your lips and sip. The effect is rich, and even though you feel like vomiting, it strengthens you. Pray at the altar. Clamber onto the altar? Let's pray. There's a clear space just before the altar. You kneel in it and bow your head. The dripping of water from the carcass overhead slows and deepens, becoming the gentle sound of the tide, and you feel the presence of the whale god Ilmon. But the voice is distant, confused. The sluggish movements of the whale are transformed, weakened and defined by violence. Pledge myself. Well, then I'm going to lose the grace of Korga. I don't want to do that. Stand. You stand from the altar once more without further supplication. What if we clamber onto the altar? You climb up onto the altar, the great head now within arm's reach. The slowed skeleton gurgles incoherently, a gasp of horror lengthened and stretched. Look at the head. Now you are close. You can see the whale's head is quite putrid, the wound on its neck ragged and savage. Strips of skin hang off the stump, frozen at the start of decomposition. Its great mouth hangs open, which you could easily fit inside. The iron hooks holding it aloft were roughly shoved in. Was this creature hung up while still whole and alive? Look inside the mouth. The water dripping from its mouth wells up from the inside of the tongue in a seemingly endless supply. Is this why the head is here? Did someone, perhaps the Archmage, capture and kill a god for a source of sanctified water? Touch the head. You touch the side of the jaw. The flesh is spongy and moist, and murky water seeps out from the pressure. It sways slightly, chains creaking. The head is warm somehow, and for a moment, a distant, massive presence slides through your mind. I don't know. Should I strike it down? This would have been another good spot for a vote. But, well, I can't have a 5-minute video here, so... I think I might be in danger if I strike down the head. But then... if the Archmage did capture this god and kill a god, maybe striking down the head will free this god. Yeah, let's try. You draw your blade. It is the only honorable thing you could do. Right. Then you swing away, rending great chunks of flesh from the head, but doesn't dull my blade. Striking near the hooks, the great weight begins to tilt. You leap away from the altar just as it crashes down. Water spills from it, dark and slick. I'll probably take that, but the head. The whale's head sits on the altar, crumpled inwards where one jawbone was smashed. The skeletons, horrified at your actions, have no chance to react. They die one shuddering death and do not stir once more. Your violence has disrupted the magic of the room. You dip your finger into the water. It does not sparkle or give off any sanctity. It is blood spew. Take a chunk of whale flesh. You go to cut a chunk of whale flesh, but is crawling with maggots and shot through with putrescent rot. You stagger away, disgusted. You stumble back from the horror of the altar and towards the doorways from the now silent chamber. Got another clue. I guess I'm going here? Did we go there? I don't even remember. Oh, so close. Glyph 4. And the Tower of Skeletons. We've definitely seen the dome. I think we've seen everything there is to see here. So let's go on to this one. Whether we've been here or not. You run over to the next tower before the wind can snatch you away. The night is drawing on. The tower has no door, just an open arch leading into shadow. Peering through the arch, you can make out some kind of yellowish light coming from within. You step inside the doorway and then stop suddenly, half blinded by a glowing luster that fills this chamber. Your footsteps crunch and you look down. It seems the floor is covered with gold, coins, jewels, and emeralds of every shade and hue. Doors lead away in both directions. Oh, that's what messed me up. Doors leads away. You cast your eyes over the treasure, drinking it in. There must be hundreds, if not thousands, of gold pieces here. More riches than one could possibly spend in a lifetime. Enough, surely, to abandon your quest entirely and move to the Southlands to be a queen in your own right. I think this is fake. But I'll try this. Fill my pockets. Oh my god. Is that real? It's probably not real. You stuff gold into your pockets until your cloak is dragging down on your shoulders like a great weight. Now, if I cast a spell, it's going to get rid of the gold I have, isn't it? If I counter this spell, heal disease I cannot cast. I might not be able to cast this spell. Summon a goblin. We're out of goblin's teeth. As of last episode, I think. See the future. Counters Dop. What is Dop? That's Doc. Hold on. Let me see my notes for Dop. Dop. Where be the Dop? Knock spell. The counter's knock. So, yeah, that's not it. Guts goblin. I'm trying to hit M. Is it M? One of the ones? Yeah. That I can't cast. That counters a force field. I hate how it does this. Sense danger. Snatta cat. it's Doc. This is the heal disease. I think I checked them all. Seeing the future already counters something. Yeah. Sorry guys, I know I'm just doing the same thing. I'm just making sure I didn't miss one. And I don't believe I did, so I'm gonna leave. Cause I can't counter this spell. Rather than fill my pack as well, I already have a great weight on me. Let's move on. It's probably gonna leave when I exit the tower. You grin with delight. You have more gold now than you ever believed possible. You'll be unstoppable once this tiresome adventure is done with. You tramp for the doors, pockets jangling. Alright, let's watch the amount of money. You continue over the bridge to the tower beyond. It is the middle of night. You should find somewhere to safe to sleep if you can. Suddenly you feel lighter. Check my pockets. Ah, I knew it! You look into your pockets, empty. It seems all the gold you picked up inside the tower has evaporated. On the threshold, you pause. This is a chamber of sadness, and you have no desire to return inside unprepared. This is a chamber. This is the sadness chamber. The one that I had trouble getting through. I think we've been to every tower now. I need I don't think I ever countered this. I need to counter, cause depression. Counters gum. What is gum? Gum is like a sticky kind of spell, I think. Gum is, yeah, web. I don't need to be countering web. So that's goblin, cannot do. Counters lightning, teleportation. Wait, I'm going in the wrong order here. New! I got GSC. Yeah, I could never find a way to... Pep? Cause strength. How about cause strength? I can't do explosions. Let's try cause strength. You bind the stars into a pattern around you. You cast a spell and drink the fire water down in one gulp where it warms your belly. Oh, I did it. I think I did it. You enter the room hoping your protection will be adequate. Its magic reaches for your soul, but you feel the fire water in your stomach and walk through unscathed. Cool. Let's leave first, because it might not be added. Let's go out. You return to the path and walk a short distance. The night air is cold. Three paths meet at this point in the shadow of the western rock. I'm going to sleep. Setting down your pack, you try to stretch out despite the cold. You have not yet eaten today, but there is nothing you can do to fill your belly. You get comfortable and rest. You roll over, trying to sleep, but you cannot seem to rest. After a while, you get to your feet and begin to walk through the darkness. Crumbling walls and broken towers move past on either side. You're walking past an old, crumbling building when you hear voices. Sure I'm not sleeping? You listen closer, leaning against the wall. It sounds like a distant crowd, too far even to be on the other side of the wall. Where are those voices coming from? Looking over the wall, you spot a missing brick. A green-gray mold has covered the gap, coating the interior with fuzz. As you lean down to peer at the mold, the voices are growing louder. Listen closely. You listen closely and hear what sounds distinctly like the hubbub of a town heard from a distance. Conversations, the banging of tools, the playing of children. But it is louder the closer to the mold you are. Curious. But then something else catches your eye. Movement. Hundreds of tiny specks swarm across the surface of the brick, making circuits in all directions around the mold. What could they be? Am I really giant-sized and looking down on those? That's the real world. You watch the hypnotic patterns in the mold, moving this way and that. They seem to grow as you stare, becoming first veins, then branches, then finally streets and roads. The world around you is filling with gray, and the air turns to fuzz and smoke. Then you are sitting in a valley of soft gray grass. You get to your feet and take in the scenery. The hills around you are a riot of greens and purples. Blotches of strange growths make dancing patterns, and everything is covered in fine fuzz. Look up. Overhead is a pitted underside of a next brick in the wall. It's rather like being in a cavern open on one side. The place you came from is indistinct. Everything out there is so large now it is nearly impossible to discern. The hill you are sitting on obscures most of your vision. Perhaps you can get a better view from the top? Alright. Calling out is overrated. You climb the hill for a better view. You look down into another valley, ringed by hills. Nestled at the floor is an extraordinary sight. So I'm deciding what is there? Creatures. They are hard to make out from this distance, but you see them hurrying to and fro in their huts. From the distance, they appear to be shapeless blobs, the same color as the mold. They seem like any other village inhabitants. They move along the ground by simply rolling. It seems you have been spotted. Hide? You look around for a hiding place, but see nothing of use. You eventually retreat a ways down the opposite side of the hill. Your plan is foiled, however, as the creatures crest it and spot you. One rolls forward and begins to speak in a rough imitation of the common tongue. Its voice sounds like a bag of pebbles, so it is a bit hard to follow. Welcome. I can't make a voice like the bag of pebbles, sorry guys. We are the Gillis, and this is our home. You have been summoned by Mucor's magic. Would you come down to the village? Mucor's magic. Who is Mucor? The Gillis bounces up and down. Mucor is the leader of Brack, and the original ancestor of my people. Mucor traveled here from another world and sees into other worlds. Will you come see Mucor? It has been decreed that you will help us. Sure, Mucor. The Gillis puffs up with pleasure. Excellent. This way, please. You will notice most do not speak your tongue. I myself only learned through careful study of passing thunderstorms. Thunderstorms taught him to speak English. Okay. You follow the group down the hill, chatting with your escort. You follow them to a village built on thousands of levels and in thousands of directions, made of spindles and spires and webbed threads. The creatures gather around you, pawing at your body, your clothing and possessions, fascinated, appalled, and uninhibited. Who are you? We are the memories of this place, the Gillis replies in a chorus. This place is too old, and yet it lives. They try to feed you from the rotten meat around which their village is built. One tries to caress you with tendrils pushed deep up your nostrils. What? You cough and choke violently as the mold fills your mouth and eyes. It's caressing me with tendrils in my deep inside my nostrils. Okay, it's time to wake up. Junction. I did sleep, didn't I? I think. You lost significant stamina, minus 12. Changed to using the broadsword, plus 1. And found 2 new clues. The Archmage is still waiting for you. That's right, I was worried about dulling my sword. I don't even have my plus 4, plus 2 sword, whatever. I think it was plus 4, turned into plus 2. Now I have this broadsword. You pick yourself to your feet and try to shake away your more curious dreams. What path will you take now? The path out of here into the next tower is probably. Now I have it. Okay. It wasn't listed in weapons before. Any more clues? That was weird. That was a weird dream or actual happening. Either one. Yeah, I think we've seen all these towers, so let's go. The early morning sun makes the air glow. You approach the next tower. The inner doors you stand in front of are twice your height and look to be made of solid metal. The air is thick with an incredible smell. I have to go through these towers. I can't just go around. No, it doesn't lead that way, does it? So I have to go through it. Isn't this the one with the swamp in it? You sniff the air, smoke, melting metal. It is as though a gigantic smithy lies beyond this door. Really? You place your ear to the metal and leap backwards. The door is searing hot. The wooden handle should be safe to touch, though. As you grasp the handle, you notice it's almost too hot to touch. The doors are very heavy, but you manage enough control to open them halfway. You spy a roaring flame just inside the door. This room must be some kind of furnace. I can't cast a spell, I guess I'm entering? You slip carefully into the room. Oh, wow. Which is filled with roaring flames. You can't see the fortress, the source of the blaze, sorry, but surely is a miracle that has not spread to the other buildings of the fortress. The flames seem to show no sign of dying down, either. You're already sweating from the heat. While the flames lick through the whole room, you might be able to pick a path through them. You stand at the room's threshold. Look around, edge forward, wait. Place aid. You look around the chamber. The walls are metal, presumably to protect the rest of the fortress, but they have the effect of making this space into an oven. There may be an exit on the far side, but through the wall of fire is impossible to say. Oh my god. Waiting was a bad idea. As you hesitate, the flames roar up. You leap back, but are still burned quite terribly. The flames flicker and burn just inches away. Hold up. I'm drinking some holy water. Drinking holy water seems very wasteful, but you quickly feel much better for it. Right. So now I can safely cast a spell that might, it's very loud now. That might cause stamina damage. Looking for a counter for fireball, I guess. That counters web. That's fireball. We know what how does. Just want to see if there's anything else. No. Create wind. That could either put out the flames or make the flames leap higher. Keep that in mind, Huff. Cause stupidity. I can't see how that would help in this situation. Don't think that could be a counter for fire. Clone the caster. We already know it counters kin. What's kin? Kin. Kin is duplicate enemy. Cause speed. Create stench. Teleportation, I think we might need the gale horn. I kept choosing this, right? So okay, so Z, no more Z. H S D N D. Yeah. Was it? Huff? Try it. You craft a spell, lifting the gale horn and blowing a loud note. But the flames do not even flicker under the force of this mighty gale. You do not see any effect. This cannot be a normal fire if it does not react to wind. Well, if I choose either of these, we're going to take stamina hits of varying quality, or not quality, but severity. I can pray for aid. I mean, all the spells that I see, they counter something, right? Or I can't cast them. Z, we cannot. We already know that counters something else. Find safe passage. Let's try that. Reaching up to the stars, you create the magic, and a steady voice begins to speak to you. But the voice has nothing to say. There is no hidden route to be discovered here. The voice fades. Curious, is there no solution to this obstacle? Or does the voice simply not know? Sweat pours from your forehead. Alright. Try some else. Dim. Cause stupidity. I can't see how that would get rid of fire. Z we tried already. SHDZ. N. Or S. Clone the caster. We already know the counter is something else. Create stench. Cause speed. Yeah, there are a lot of things I can't cast. So I'm going to pray for aid. You close your eyes and raise a prayer to Korga. Opening your eyes, you see the flames shimmer for a moment, revealing a bare room. An illusion. The flames are not real. However, you know that some illusions can still injure those who believe in them, so you must act with confidence. Confidence. Got it. Running through, then. You fling yourself into the room, sprinting through the fire as you were told. Flames lick your clothes. Keep going. You keep going. You are halfway across, and there is no heat, no burn. The flames are cool to your skin. The information about this room is correct. You reach the end of the room unharmed. By the door, you see a grimalkin. Investigate the sculpture. You investigate the grimalkin, if I'm saying that right. It is much like the Crown of Kings itself is, if what the Sightmaster told you is true. A bracelet made of ivory or bone hangs on one of the arms. I'm gonna take the bracelet. Just looking here. There's something like that. Bracelet of bone, I believe, is something. Ah! Yes. Bracelet of bone is used with the KID spell, K-I-D, Enhanced Illusion. Alright, definitely taking that. You lift the bracelet of bone from the arm. Immediately, the fire in the room disappears. Without the bracelet, it seems the Kremalkin cannot sustain the illusion. You know? Cause stupidity might have been the counter for this spell. Because the opposite of stupidity is intelligence, which could be used to counter or, like, make a saving throw, if you like, from Dungeons and Dragons lingo, against the illusion. You leave the room behind. I want to go back in and try that spell, if I can. You step back out onto the path and make your way along it. You reach the base of a stone tower with a curved archway at its base. The path splits around it. The very air around you seems fetid and mean. Which route will you choose? So it's pretty cool. I didn't realize we didn't go in this tower. I want to cast that spell. The air stirs a little. Still cold but fresh. You follow the path and make your way into the tower once again. The doors to the inner chamber are half open. There is no light coming from inside. The spell in this chamber is gone. You walk easily across the large stone chamber. I can't cast it now. We still hear that, but I can't cast it. Yeah. Alright, let's go. This place feels like an open coffin, as though you were an ant, exploring the contours of its ruffled velvet lining. What is there here to explore? We've seen everything, I believe. You make your way along the path towards the wall and the door set within it. You could explore deeper or escape back to the relative safety of Mempang. We will do the latter. You slip through the door once more and back into the square. Which way now? Forward. We're going to head to the western section of this town. You return to the middle of a small square. Guards loiter around the flagstones. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. Pleasant smells float over from the food tent. This is not a good place to hang around. Yeah, I wish we had unlimited gold. Well, nearly. I'd get more of those eyeball things, but they're kind of expensive at 8 gold pieces a pop. You return to the edge of the square. As the sun climbs the sky, the wind's blowing through the throwing through the streets rise. Guards walk this way and that across the square. You could elbow your way through the strange crowds filling the square. You return to the crossroads near the tangled alleyways. No. Explore the alleys or follow the road. You could return to the alleys or make your way across Mampang. I want to go to this pub or this inn, whatever the hell it is again. Get some food. You make your way along the alleyway. A lane leads off. The sun has reached its highest point now. There's no time to waste. Yeah, I can't go there, though. Alright. Hopefully I can find something else to eat. You leave the alley and step into the edge of the central square of the city. The arch to the merchant's building leads away here. An alley runs past it. A pillory sits to the north of here. You are into the hottest hours of the day, and yet this place is still cold. You could cross the square or explore the fringes. I'm gonna cross the square. I don't know if we've looked at these buildings at all. The sun is beginning to lower, and the air begins to cool. Seriously, we haven't done that much. You stride out into the middle of the public square where Mampang's inhabitants go about their business. In the center is a large statue of a faceless man holding a crown aloft, the Archmage. Have I looked at this? The statue seems unimaginably old, and yet the Archmage depicted here is definitely holding the crown of kings. Has he been planning the theft for such a long time, then? Or is this prophecy, a celebration of a day destined to come? Many people here are simply passing through, but several are browsing the market on the west side. You also spot several guards to the north clustered around a road that leads upwards. Can I cast some kind of spell on this statue? Stone to flesh. Do we have that spell? I'm not sure. Talk all languages. Let's try it. Removing the green wig, you pull it onto your head and complete the spell. You discreetly follow a small group of goblins as they wander the square and listening to their chatter. I hear the master of taxes is changing her gauntlet, one says. Really? The nobility must be getting bored, another responds. But maybe this time it will be easier, eh? Shove off! You'll still be killed, the first goblin says. What's the good of it anyway? Demands a second. They say there's another world in there, but it can't be true, can it? They continue arguing, soon turning into a street. There are guards patrolling frequently, even here. You'll have to be careful to blend in, especially with the citadel on alert. But your guard's uniform should help. Now let's get this green wig off of us then. Can't exactly blend in with a green wig, I don't think. See the future? What's this one? I'll float in the air. You sit cross-legged on the ground and put your palms on the orb. You wind the constellations into alignment around you, and everything changes. A trio of birdmen watch you with narrowed, suspicious eyes, but you can see it is they who have a secret to protect. The vision fades. Being so near the gates means there is a greater number of merchants and travelers here. The further into the keep you go, the inhabitants will become increasingly wary of outsiders. See what else we can do. Without lowering stamina. Talk with animals? You weave the enchantment, but nothing in particular happens. There are no animals nearby to communicate with. No matter the time, the square is bustling. Mampang is isolated, but active. Okay. Anything else? Heal disease. Sense danger. Cause depression. No use for that. So I want to make the statue depressed. S-H-T-E. Read minds. You cast the enchantment, pulling on the cloth skull cap as you do so. From all around the square come a multitude of thoughts. You concentrate to pick one out. A nearby monk is shaking with fear. "Those red eyes," he murmurs to himself. "They are God-fearing. But I fear them." You remove the cap once more. No matter the weather, the square is crowded. I think we're done with spells. I thought I was going to be casting them on the statue, but anything but. That's how. I think it's how. I missed the O, yeah. Yeah, I think we're done. Alright. Make a move. You could head in several directions from here. You have found one new clue. Wonder what the clue is. The red eyes respect monks. Oh, the red eyes of Kare. The red eyes are deeply religious and respect the city's monks. That's cool. Okay, so we got the market, the west side. West side. Let's go to market. I do need food. The market is busy with traders and stalls in a city in miniature. The market is not as large as those you encountered in Kare, but still it bustles with life. Even in Manpang, people need to go about their day. The tents and the stalls. Have I gone here? Well, that was laughing. There are a few large tents set up and some stone buildings, too. There's a hawker loudly proclaiming that mysteries and wonders await in his tent. In one corner, a long line of creatures queue outside a low stone building. Let's go to the hawker first. Probably not get anything. You walk by the hawker who is plying her trade to the crowd. "Examine a wondrous stone of secrets," she cries. "Marvel as it speaks, advises, and prophesies." You approach the hawker who points right at you. Now here is a discerning patron of the weird and wonderful. Will she enter and experience the mysteries that even our best magical knowledge cannot explain? What is it? She puffs herself up. "The Stone of Secrets is an incredibly rare artifact, discovered deep within a lost cave many moons ago. It is the only stone in the world which can speak. It is not powered by magic, but a strange alien force unique in the old world. The greatest magicians of our age have examined it and walked away confounded." Where are you from? "I'm a proud daughter of the Eighth Slum," she replies. "But they say my family were once great travelers and traders, crossing the whole of the old world. Can you imagine such a journey?" "Indeed I can." She nods. "Of course. I could tell from the moment I saw you. You were the type to accept adventures, such as this one." She taps the stone beside her meaningfully. "How much?" "You may enter for the astonishingly small sum of 2 gold pieces. What a bargain. What a steal. Only 2. Yes, 2 gold pieces for an entertaining, enlightening, life-changing experience." Sure, why not? It's only 2. You pay the fee and the hawker beams, her gaze already slipping past you. Here's a brave soul who has chosen to embrace mystery and wonder. Who will follow her? Hopefully nobody. I don't want to be followed. Inside the tent, it is dim and cramped. A large stack of boxes sits to one side, a cloth draped over them. Other curiosities, no doubt, that the hawker is shelved in favor of the more profitable stone. Search the boxes. You begin to rifle through the boxes when suddenly you are stopped short. Then a voice booms through the tent. "Annalander!" A familiar voice. The Archmage? Oh no. The voice is familiar, but quite impossible. It is the booming tone of Shadrach, the hermit from the Backlands. "Shadrach?" "Yes, it is I. It is good to see you again," he laughs again. "After a fashion, at least." "What happened?" "I found a piece of my spirit, or I bound a piece of my spirit to this rock. A desperate move." "Why?" "The Archmage's assassins found my cave. I was staked outside on a cross. My body is still there, wasting away. I was able to project a fragment of myself into this stone, another into a tree. I will avenge you." "I thank you, but you must forget about the troubles of an old man. Focus on your mission. Without the crown, my suffering will pale in comparison to that of the old world." Is there a way to counter the power of the crown? Shadrach thinks for a moment. That is a good question. I believe so, yes. It is magical, and so, like all magic, its effects can be countered with the correct counterspells.
What are the spells?
The rock rolls a little in a half shrug. I could only guess. Spells of illusion? The reading of the will? Of confusion?
Well, I do know some illusion spells.
Unfortunately, I couldn't counter that, could I? If only I could put the bracelet of bone back. How'd you get to Manpeng? A stroke of luck, though I cannot tell if it was good or bad. Not many travel near my cave, so when the woman outside did, I was overjoyed. I immediately spoke to her. Learning her trade, of sorts, I convinced her I was an ancient artifact. I bid her to take me to Manpeng. Perhaps I sold my fiction too well. She scooped me up and took a lengthy detour to villages on the way. I was forced to give advice and spin dreary prophecies. The rock rotates ever so slightly on its base. But how can I aid you? How goes your journey? I see the serpents did not eat you.
What is in the abandoned towers? You ask.
That is the Inner College of Manpeng, he answers. A place where magic was discovered and researched. The spellbook you carry is based on the researches made in this place.
Tell me of the Throben doors, you say.
I can only tell you so much, replies the rock, sadly. I know there are trapped with spells, three spells, and a fourth that requires the great Throben to take his life to seal the threshold for all time. But what the spells are, or how they might be overcome, I cannot learn, because no one knows.
How can I overcome the power of the crown?
You ask. How can I reach the Archmage in safety? The only way to do it is go via the Throben doors. Open them, and the Archmage will fall. The rock rattles and then falls still for a time. I am sorry, Annalander. I lack the strength to continue speaking, it whispers finally. My body has already failed, and my spirit cannot stay anchored to this rock forever. Keep your wits about you, and know that I am proud. The rock stills as Shadrach's voice fades. So I found one new clue and one updated. Throben doors. Locked by fearsome magic, the College of Magic is overrun by wild magic. The Inner College of Manpeng. Interesting. Okay, done with that. Outside the tent, the hawker claps you on the shoulder. Well, friend, she says, did the stone unlock the mysteries of the universe for you? Did it dazzle your senses? Delight your spirit? You're exploiting that creature. Of course not, the hawker chuckles. How could I do that? It's a rock. It needs only visitors, but that mission requires donations, you see, as there are a variety of expenses. The hawker's words flow like oil, slippery let empty. You leave mid-sentence. You walk away without another word. You go back into the market. Let's check the fortune teller. I'm not going to pay for a fortune. Probably not. You join a long line of creatures outside the low stone building of the fortune teller. They are waiting with surprising patience. Let's talk to the creature ahead of us. The creature in front of you is a hobgoblin with long blonde hair. Blonde hair? And a hobgoblin? And two protruding hooked teeth. Greetings. She turns to you with an indifferent look, then looks away. Or turns away. What is inside this building? You don't know? Why are you waiting here, if you don't know? I saw the line.
So you just joined?
Well, and she shrugs, I suppose when I first joined the line it was for the same reason, but it seems so long ago now.
How long have you been waiting?
This time? A few hours, maybe.
What do you mean, this time?
She shrugs. Well, this isn't my first visit. No one visits wide only once. She pauses to scratch her chin. If you don't mind, I'd like to get back to waiting.
Shall I wait?
You wait. A thin creature emerges from the building with a curious half-smile on his face. The next creature, a dwarf, enters.
I'll be polite and wait.
You continue waiting. Nothing happens. You continue to wait, and the dwarf emerges. She, too, has a curious half-smile on her face. A black elf goes inside next. Waiting. Wait a little longer.
The black elf emerges, looking furious about something. A wood golem enters the building. The creatures in the line stir a little, but no one leaves the queue. Waiting. The wood goblin emerges, looking furious about something. A goblin goes inside. The creatures in the line stir a little. The hobgoblin emerges, looking furious about something. A hobgoblin is next. I say the hobgoblin emerges? I said that by mistake. A guard enters the building. I'm gonna wait one more time. A small moth child goes inside? Okay, push to the front. You slip out of the line again, which closes behind you immediately, and you walk towards the door of the building. A rat-faced orc stops you. What do you think you're doing? I heard the teller's name is Wide. The rat-faced orc shrugs. That's right. So what? I want to see if it's worth waiting for. Oh, it's worth it, the rat-faced orc replies. This is my 13th time. Let's push our way inside. You push the creature aside and barge your way into the building. To your surprise, those waiting in the line give no response. You step inside the low building just as a small moth child leaves. Inside, the room appears to be empty. Then a moment later, you notice a squat, ugly figure behind the door, clutching a pot. The creature meets your eyes and stares with fear. It is clear he was about to strike you on the head. Grab the pot. You grab for the pot and toss it away into the corner. Sorry about that, he says bashfully. I saw you coming, you see. I knew you'd be trouble. I mean you no harm, you declare, but Wide only shakes his head. I'm afraid that's not true, he replies. You just don't realize it yet, I think. That's the trouble with foresight. Always see trouble coming. You truly are a fortune teller? He nods, sadly. More's the pity. Farron Wide is at your service. Under his breath he adds, please leave. What is my fortune? You demand. But Wide shakes his head. Won't say. Can't make me say. Why not? Got my reasons, he replies through tightened lips, as though worried the words will rush out of their own accord unless he holds them back. Threaten him? You ball your fingers into a fist and Wide cowers. Told you you'd make trouble, he whimpers. I'm never wrong, see? So tell me my fortune. Farron is clearly terrified, but still shakes his head. Won't do it, he replies. Shan't. Bribe him? Don't have that much money. Okay, I'm gonna leave it here, actually. I only have 23 gold. I do want to spend some of that on rations. So keeping that in mind, shall we bribe him? Tell him he's an imposter, or wave him away. Wave him away. I guess we're dismissing him. Or we might be leaving the tent at that point. I'm not sure. So leave your comments, leave your votes in the comments section below. Shall we bribe him with, I don't know how much gold? You're an imposter, tell him, or wave him away. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Thanks for voting. And endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.